Let me slide this over. I'm going to step up one time, okay? Good morning, everyone. I want you to meet Cooper. This is Cooper Belitsis. Cooper's parents are Jeff and Shannon. Cooper is a fourth grader. He goes to Indian Lake Elementary. And his most favorite thing to do would be Legos. Number two is swimming. He's on a swim team. He loves to swim. And he loves commando football. He is the ball boy for the freshman team. And he gave me a list. The list went on and on. I said, stop. I can't remember all that. So I got the top three, and I think I'm doing pretty good there. Cooper became a Christian back in the summer, back in June, at FCA camp, Fellowship of Christian Athletes. And I'm sure it's something he had been thinking about. But I asked him, I said, you remember the prayer that you prayed? He said, yeah, I asked Jesus to come into my heart. And, of course, it was about the sin problem. He realizes that even though he's a good kid, we all, whether we consider ourselves good or not, we've got the same problem, and it's a sin problem. And the only solution to that is forgiveness through Jesus Christ. And Cooper's taking care of that. Cooper, we're proud of you, buddy. Tell everyone this morning, who's Jesus to you?
My Lord and Savior.
Cooper, on your profession of faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Bury with him in baptism. Race to walk in newness of life.
Trust your ways are higher. You alone are my desire. Nothing else will do. My eyes are fixed on you. You are good. You are here, leading me in all your ways. My delight, my reward, all my life for all my days. I'll trust your guiding hand. My Father and my friend, your faith will till the may fail, but your strength alone prevails. So I'm clinging to the promise, I'm your child and not forgotten. When I'm weak and broken within, you remind me of your faithfulness again. Trust your guiding hand. My Father and my friend, your faithful till the end. So I'll sing of all your goodness, and I'll tell of all your works. Make my life a living story till all have seen and heard. You good. You are here, leading me in all your ways. My delight, my reward, all my life for all my days. I'll trust your guiding hand. My Father,
amen. He's faithful to the end. Do you agree with that? Let's stand together. Let's sing this great hymn. Have faith in God. He is still on the throne. Let's sing it together.
Have faith in God when your pathway is lonely. He sees and knows all the way you have trod. Never alone are the least of his children.
Good morning. Welcome this morning. It's wonderful to be in God's house today. In just a moment, we're going to go to together to the Lord in prayer. But I had a testimony shared this morning with me. We have some family members of some of our members that are from down on the Gulf Coast that are here while the hurricane's coming in today. But one of these visitors shared that over the past year, they had a loss and a special need and were placed on the prayer list of our church, and just shared this morning how those prayers sustained them this past year through the notes that were sent and through the prayers that were given, and want to thank the church for the prayers. You know, I know that that testimony can be multiplied over and over and over again. What an incredible privilege it is for us to be able to take others to God's throne. And this morning, let's do so. Let's continue to remember those that were impacted by the floods in Waverly last weekend that are still dealing with the loss of many, many family members and the physical loss. And today, pray for those that are on the Gulf Coast as the hurricane comes in today and those people that will be impacted. Let's lift them up in prayer this morning. So would you bow together and pray with me? Our Father, this morning, we thank you that you're a God that delights to hear our prayers. You're not an unknown God. You're not some foreign God, but you're our Father. And you love for us just to come before you to share our hearts. And this morning we share our hearts that are full of praise for all of your good, for all of your goodness, for all of your blessings. Father, we thank you this past week for the blessings that you have poured out upon our church. Last Sunday afternoon, seeing well over 50 people pray to or make their public profession of faith public through baptism. To thank you for an incredible marriage retreat of families whose marriages are strengthened. An incredible fellowship on Friday night and a wonderful time of challenge last night for the men of our church. Lord, your blessings have been upon us and so many other times this past week that you've blessed us. We thank you for that. But Father, you also have given us the privilege and the responsibility to be able to lift others up in intercessory prayer. And we do so this morning as a congregation. We pray for those that have lost loved ones right here in our own state through the flood last weekend. Lord, may your comfort be upon them. We pray that many will be drawn to Jesus Christ through this. We pray for those that have lost their homes and physical possessions. Lord, may they see you as the great provider. We pray for those that are in the path of the storm today in Louisiana and beyond. Lord, would your hand be upon them, protect them. And Lord, may you just meet all of their needs that they have. Lord, this morning, though we've come together to worship you, to thank you, to praise you, to lift your name high and lift the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, today, you and you alone are worthy of our praise and our worship. We worship you. Lord, we lift up our pastor to you. We pray today that you will empower him. You will give him a clarity of voice and of mine to be your voice this morning. Prepare our hearts to receive what you have for us. Through Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. I want to take a moment to welcome guests this morning. We had several guests in our early service. I know we have in this service as well. Welcome to First Baptist Hendersonville this morning. Worship the Lord with us today. That is our desire. If you are a guest, we'd love to know about your presence here. If you were given a bulletin on the way in, there's a little tab in the bulletin. If you wouldn't mind, fill that out, detach it. And on the way out, Pastor and I'll be out in the foyer. Please bring it by. We want to say thank you for being here today. Would like to present a challenge to you this morning as we shared last week. We knew there'd be a lot of needs because of the flood in Waverly, and our Tennessee Baptist Convention is on the ground. Disaster relief is working today. They have been for several days now. We will probably be taking a team over in a couple of weeks to work. They ask if we could wait just a little while, and we'll be going over in a couple of weeks, but there are some financial needs. Our stewardship committee this past week sent $20,000 to the Tennessee Baptist Convention to help with the financial needs in that community, and we know there'll be other needs as the hurricane comes in today as well. Pastor and I like to present a challenge this morning, and that is if 500 of us, there'll be about 3,000 in our services today, if 500 of us would give $100 each, that'll be $50,000, and our church could give $70,000 this week to disaster relief to help the people immediately. Don and I and Pastor and Joy have led the way, each of us providing $100. There's only 496 others that need to join us now, this morning. So if you would prayerfully consider doing that, you can put your check out in the offering boxes out in the foyer. You can bring it by the church office this week, or go online, and you can make your contribution there as well. But every penny will go to help the people that are in need from these storms. Thank you so much. Greg, let's continue.
Jesus' blood.
Bless the Lord. You may be seated, congregation.
Yeah. Amen, amen. I love this choir and I love this orchestra. And you know the amazing thing about them is they just give of their time. God has blessed them all with a talent and they give back to Him because they love Him and they want to serve Him. And I love you all and thank you so much for your faithful ministry. What a great, great week we've had in our church. Bruce has already mentioned this, I'm sure, but with the baptism service last Sunday night, this week, just all week long, just great things happening. Jerry had over 350 or so seniors, over 55, I'm not supposed to use that ugly word, 55 and up, folks, 55 and up gathered together for fellowship Friday night. Last night, over 500 men. Think about that, sink in now on a Saturday night. 500 men came together, and we want to see God do something in us. You know, we ought to be able, with that group of men, and with men from other churches all over this community, we're not in this by ourselves. There are other people that love the Lord all over this community. We ought to be able to turn this world right side up, shouldn't we? We ought to be able to turn our community right side up for the gospel of Christ if we just are serious and sincere about what we say we believe. If we say we believe it, we ought to live that way. Now, our passage today is in Philippians chapter 1. If you're visiting with us, I met several first-time visitors today. I walked up to another couple just a minute ago, assumed that I already knew them. They said, hey, this is our first time here. I said, well, how did you know me? Because they addressed me as pastor, and they said, well, we've been watching online. It happens every week. People come for the first time. If you are visiting with us, we study through books of the Bible. We are in the book of Philippians. We are finishing up the first chapter this morning, so we're right toward the end of it. If you want to find your copy of Scripture and look at it, you know, I'm so thankful for modern technology and all that we have, and we've got a lot of folks that enjoy using their phone or iPad or something like that for their Bible, and I do that too. I'm not putting it down because I do it too, and it's so convenient. You've got it right there with you. But you know, you can be sitting in your favorite chair at your house and be on your iPad or your iPhone, and your kids, grandkids, whoever, they don't know what you're doing. You could be playing a game. You could be reading the morning news. You could be on porn, you know. You could be doing anything on that. They don't necessarily know what you're doing. But when you take this, you're only doing one thing with this. This is God's Word, and it's for one purpose, and there's nothing exactly like holding God's Word in your hand and turning. So if you have a Bible with you, turn to it. If you've got a phone, then you don't turn to it. What do you do? Find it. I don't know what you do with that, but click on it, whatever. But Philippians chapter 1, we're going to read the final verses here in just a moment. In 2004, I had a friend down in Alabama named Sammy Gilbreth. Sammy was the director of evangelism for the Alabama Convention. He did the same thing in Alabama that Larry Gilmore did here for the Tennessee Baptist Convention. He was the director of evangelism. And Sammy was diagnosed in 2004 with an inoperable heart condition. His doctors told him that there was nothing they could do. Surgically, it was impossible to treat it. And they called it a ticking time bomb. Now, the thing was, Sammy didn't feel bad, other than just a checkup and just good doctors that found that he had this problem. He didn't feel bad. And so the doctors told him that since he felt well and there was really, he wasn't going to cause it any more harm, there was nothing you could do to help or hurt, so just go on with his life. Just go on with his life and do what he always did. So that's what Sammy did. He continued to preach and he continued to be a director of evangelism and do the things that he would have always done. And in the course of that, they told him that he probably would live about 6 months. This was in 2004. He'd live about 6 months just to live his life. And so he developed a sermon during that period of time that he entitled, Live Like You're Dying. Live Like You're Dying. I heard him preach that sermon several times. I've heard him several more times because 17 years later, he's still living and preaching that sermon. His time hasn't come yet, but it's an interesting concept that he talked about. Now, I think sometimes when people hear somebody say something like that, live like you're dying, they get this thought, okay, if this was my last day on earth, if when I woke up this morning, I got a note from God, and the note said, you will not see the sunset today. This is your last day on earth. I think we've got in our mind that what it means to live like you're dying is that we would frantically be going around and trying to find every bridge that we had burned and trying to restore some things and fix some relationships and tell some people that we love them that we hadn't told that in a long time and try to make some things right and apologize and just try to fix a lot of things, and we'd be running around like a chicken with our head cut off if we knew this was our last day. But that's not really what that means. To live like you're dying does not mean that you've got 12 hours to fix everything that you haven't done right over the last X number of years. What it means is to live every day so that if this were your last day, you have no regrets. You don't have any bridges that need to be rebuilt. You don't have any apologies that you need to go and make. You've already done those things. You've spoken words of affirmation and words of love and appreciation. You have been living like this could be your last day on earth. Now, that is exactly what Paul says in this passage that I'm about to read. And not only this passage, but really all of what we've read so far in the first chapter of Philippians. That's what he's been saying, because remember, he's in prison. He wasn't sure if he was going to get out of prison. Now, we know in hindsight, we now know that he did get out only to be rearrested about 5 or 6 years later, and that time he would be put to death. But he didn't know if this would be the time that he would be put to death. So that's really what he's talking about to the Philippians as he encourages them with this letter. Now, let's see what he says beginning in verse 27. He says, just one thing. Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or am absent, I will hear about you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, working side by side for the faith of the gospel, not being frightened in any way by your opponents. This is evidence of their destruction, but of your deliverance, and this is from God. For it has been given to you on Christ's behalf not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him, having the same struggle that you saw I had and now hear about me. Now, I want to show you four things this morning out of this passage. And there are a lot more than that. You'll see some other things that maybe I don't mention today. And if I came back next week and preached on this same passage, I could say four more things that I don't even talk about today. You never get everything that there is out of Scripture. You never squeeze all of the juice out of Scripture, because God's Word is dynamic and He speaks to us in our circumstances and situation day by day as life changes. But let me show you four things that I think this passage says. Now, the first one is in verse 27, and it's in the first part of 27. And what he says here is that you ought to live your life. Here's the first word I'm going to use. I'll use four different words. You ought to live your life with consistency. Consistency. Now, I wrestled with this a little bit, what word to use. I thought about using the word conduct. That'd be a good word. I thought about using the word character. That'd be a good word as well. But I decided on this word consistency. He wants us to be consistent in the way we live our lives. Look at what he says. Just one thing. Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel. One of the greatest threats to Christianity has always been lukewarm or inconsistent Christians. And by that, I mean these people that their religion, and when I use the word religion, I use it specifically because they really don't have a relationship with the Lord. They've just got religion. Their religion is based on time and place. And if it's the right time and they're in the right place, they can be as religious as anybody else. And so Sunday morning, when they're at church, whether they're at 9:45 or 11 or they're the 8:30 crew, you know, when they're at church, when they're in the right place and it's the right time, they put on their church vocabulary. They put on their church clothes. Remember having church clothes? You used to call them church go-to-meeting clothes, you know. We don't do that so much anymore. It used to be that we had those special things in our closet. That was our dress-up stuff. And I remember having Sunday shoes. How many of you men had Sunday shoes, you know? I remember Dad on Saturday night, he'd get out that day's newspaper and he'd put it out on the table and he'd get his Sunday shoes and my Sunday shoes. And every now and then Mom would give him some of hers and he'd polish all those shoes up. We'd get ready for church. We dressed different on Sunday than we did any other day of the week. Now, that's not necessarily true anymore, and I'm not saying that's a good or a bad thing. I'm not speaking to that either way. Don't leave and think that that was the point of the message. I'm making this point with that. It really doesn't matter about the clothes we wear. It does matter how we live. And if we live one way on Sunday and we act one way on Sunday and we've got one vocabulary on Sunday, but when we're at work on Monday morning, it's a totally different ball game. We speak differently. We act differently. We are different. If we act differently on Friday night, if we act differently on Saturday night, if there's no consistency in our life as a follower of Jesus Christ, we are doing great service to His cause. And Paul says just this one thing. Live your life in a manner that is worthy of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He's going to write to the Colossian Christians, the Christians of Colossae, over in chapter 1, verse 17. This is a passage about the centrality of Christ. It's a beautiful passage, the whole thing. But in the middle of this great passage, he says, he, talking about Jesus, he is before all things, and by him, Jesus, all things stick together. The King James Version uses the word consist. By him all things consist. Our word for glue comes from that word. God wants us to have a consistency in the way that we live our lives. And one of the greatest dangers, one of the greatest threats to Christianity in 2021, just like it was in 1991 and 1951, is inconsistent Christians. That we act one way, we speak one way, we live one way, one day of the week, or in certain situations and circumstances, but totally different another time. He wants our conduct, he wants our character to be consistent. Jesus said, let your yes be yes and your no be no. Be who you are. You are a follower of Jesus, so live your life consistently. Now, the second thing I want you to see is also in verse 27, but it's in the second part of verse 27. And there are several words that I could have used for this too, but I landed on the word cooperation. If you really want to live your life as though this could be your last day, and it could be. If you want to live your life, as Paul says we're supposed to in this passage, we've got to learn to cooperate with each other. I could have used the word communicate, a lot of different words. Look at what he says at the end, the second part of verse 27. He says, then whether I come and see you or am absent, I will hear about you that you're standing firm in one spirit with one mind, working side by side for the faith of the gospel. I'm going to find that you are working together, that you are not seeing each other as competitors, but that you are seeing yourselves as partners. We are cooperating in ministry. Now, he just said that he wants us to be consistent. See, too many of us are like Jekyll and Hyde. Remember the old story, the strange tale of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde? And during the day, he was a prominent physician who treated people and did good. By night, he was a lunatic who roamed around the streets of London doing all kinds of despicable things. Too many of us are that way. You know, we're one thing by day and another thing by night. Be consistent. And now he says cooperate. He says stand shoulder to shoulder. Stand side by side. It's the picture of an army. Now, you and I might not think that way so much because we don't deal with that reality personally, though that's still a part of the world around us. We don't deal with that personally. Think about a ball team. You know, a ball team needs everybody on that team. Now, you can have the greatest quarterback in the Southeastern Conference, but you also need a center, and you need a right guard and a left tackle, and you need a tailback, and you need a tight end. You need all of those positions, and everybody needs to do their part, and everybody can't do the same thing. Everybody just needs to do their part. And if we all come to understand that, that's what he's saying in this passage. I'm looking to see that you're cooperating with each other. Now, how does that happen? Well, he tells us. Look at what he says there at the end of verse 27. He says that you will be standing in one spirit. You see, the amazing thing about this is that God puts His Spirit inside of us. Now, if God's Spirit is truly inside of me, and God's Spirit is inside of Bruce, and God's Spirit is inside of Jerry, and God's Spirit is inside of you, then God's Spirit inside of us ought to draw us to each other. Now, do we have some differences? Yes, we have some different personalities. We see things a little bit differently. One group of Christians here may interpret something a little bit different this way, or somebody over here may interpret it a little bit different that way. But if the Holy Spirit of God lives inside of us, then we ought to see each other as brothers and sisters in Christ, and we ought to work together for this furtherance of the gospel that he's talking about. We've got to learn to understand that we are in this together. And we need each other. And I'm telling you, with all of the people in this community who say that we are followers of Jesus, I'm talking about community church. I'm talking about Long Hollow Church. I'm talking about Gallatin First Baptist. I'm talking about Northfield down the street. I'm talking about the church across the street. If everybody in this community who says that they're followers of Jesus Christ, if we just started living like that, and if there was a consistency in us in the way that we actually live our lives, and if we cooperated with each other because of this spirit that is inside of us, we would turn this community upside down overnight. There is no reason for this community to be in the trouble that it's in when it's filled with as many people who say that we're followers of Jesus Christ. It ought to make a difference. And it makes a difference when we cooperate with each other, communicate with each other. That's what he's talking about there. Churches always have trouble with this. You know, it's an old story. You've probably heard it, as I have all my life, about the church that came into some money. You know, that's the quickest thing to get a church in a fight. Let them have some money. And they came into some money. Somebody left them some money. And they got into an argument in a business meeting. I've been your pastor for 12 years. We've had a lot of business meetings, and I don't remember an argument that we've had here. And I thank the Lord for that. But this church got in an argument in a business meeting, and everybody had an idea what to do with that money. Somebody wanted to buy new choir robes. Somebody wanted to get a new air conditioner. Somebody wanted to put it in the youth ministry. Somebody wanted to buy a new vehicle. Everybody had ideas, and they were all being tossed around. And finally, this idea of some chandeliers had come up, and people started kind of latching on to that. And so it looked like that was where it was going. And an elderly gentleman in the back, who was kind of the voice of the church, he finally stood up, and he said, "Look, we're not buying chandeliers. We're not spending this money on chandeliers." And he said, "I'll give you three reasons." He said, "Number one, we don't have anybody in this church that can spell chandelier, and we'll never get it ordered. Number two, we don't have anybody in this church that can play a chandelier. And number three, what we really need in this church are some lights. We're going to buy some lights. We've got to learn to cooperate. We've got to learn to communicate. And when we do that as the body of Christ, I'm telling you, we can change our community. Are you fed up with the way things are? Well, stop belly aching about it, and let's all stand shoulder to shoulder, side by side, as soldiers of the cross. Let's live our lives as followers of Jesus Christ. Let's start living out the things that we say we believe, and I'm telling you, we'll turn our community right side up, and we will do it very quickly. Now, there's a third thing that he says. Look on down just a little bit further. Go down to verse 28. Here's the third word I want to point out to you. I'm going to use the word courage, because he says there in verse 28, not being frightened in any way by your opponents. Now, a couple of things I want to point out about that. Number one, he doesn't say not being frightened if you have opponents. Not being frightened if you stumble into a kind of a troubling situation. He just presupposes that they've got opponents. He just knows that that's the reality. Now, do you think Paul knows anything about dealing with opposition? Remember what Paul wrote to the Corinthians? He said that he had been stoned almost to death in Lystra. He had been lowered in a basket in Damascus and snuck out of town under the cover of darkness. He had been shipwrecked in Mileta. He had been put in prison in Philippi. And ultimately, he is going to be killed in Rome. This is a man who knows something about trouble and about opposition. And he said, you can live your life in such a way that as you face your opponents, not if you face your opponents, but as you face your opponents, you can live your life with courage without being frightened. I'm telling you, we are living in a world, we are living in a day, we are living in a culture that is being ruled by fear. Fear is everywhere around us, and the picture that he is painting here is of us coming together, and like an army, we put our arms together, we stand shoulder to shoulder, we stand one after the other, one in front, one behind, and as the army of God, we stand without fear because we are standing together. He has not given us a spirit of fear. He has given us a spirit of courage and a sound mind. He is going to be with us, and he tells us that we can face our opponents. We can face our opponents. We can do it without being frightened. Do you see that word frightened? Without being frightened in any way. Now, that is a word picture. The New Testament is full of words that are pictures. This is one of them. It's a picture of a horse. Now, if you've ever been around a horse, you know that if you walk up to a horse, you do not just throw your hand up, even if you just want to pet the horse. You don't just walk up and quickly throw your hand up. That horse will recoil his head, his eyes will get large, his ears and his nostrils will flare, and you will frighten that horse. You know, if you've ever been around them, that you walk up very slowly and you have your hand extended so that that horse can get used to you, maybe sniff your hand, and then you pet the horse or pat the horse on his head. You do that very slowly. Now, this is a picture of a horse that has been trained for battle. Have you ever thought about how much work must have gone into getting horses ready to be in combat? This is a horse that has been trained that if swords are being slung in his face all around him, if arrows are flying with the noise of warfare all around him, this is a picture of an animal that is going to stand in the midst of the fight because he has been conditioned, he has been trained to be there and to be courageous. That's the word that's used here. And you and I need each other, so we stand together. Listen, God made us that we need each other. I'm so thankful for the internet. We have something today that, you know, 20 years ago we would have had to pay hundreds of thousands of dollars to have just a television program that we could put on, and the only people who could get it would be people who lived in our immediate area. Now, today, through internet, all you have to do is have a little equipment. We've got people that watch in Texas and Arkansas and Alabama and Kentucky and Florida and other countries around the world. And it's an incredible opportunity that we have. But I'm telling you something, it's not the same as being here. It's not the same as being here. God made us to need each other. We need to stand shoulder to shoulder. We need to stand arm in arm. We need to be together. We're the body of Christ. We're the army of God. And we need each other. And it is that being together that gives us courage. That's why Scripture talks so much about being together. Let us exalt His name together. Let us call on His name. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We need each other. Well, there's a last thing I want to show you. It's in verse 29. Look over there. The fourth word I want to give you is the word Christ-like. Now, this is a little bit of a shock. Look at what he says in verse 29. He said, for it has been given to you. This is a gift from God. It has been given to you on Christ's behalf, not only to believe in him. Now, so far, you and I would say, amen, amen. It's been given to us to believe in him. But look at the next phrase. But also to suffer for him. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'm telling you, that's not what you will hear from the health and prosperity gospel preachers. They will tell you that if you love God enough and if you give enough to their ministry, that God's going to return that 100-fold on you or 150-fold. God's going to bless you. That it's not God's will that you have any illness. It's not God's will that you have any problems. If you have any illness, if you have any problems, it's just because you haven't been living right and you haven't been giving enough and praying enough and doing all the right things. And God's plan for you is to just sail through life without any problems. That is the health and wealth and prosperity gospel. And they'll never read this verse to you. Because this verse says that the gift that God has given to you is not only that you know Him, not only that you've been forgiven for your sin and you're in a relationship with Him, that you believe in Him, but also to suffer for Him. Preacher, how can that be the truth? How can it be a gift from God that we suffer in this world? Well, let me read you a couple of verses. Paul wrote this to the Romans, chapter 8, verse 18. He said, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing to the glory that's going to be revealed in us. He wrote to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians, chapter 4, for our momentary affliction is producing for us, this is what it does, this is the momentary affliction, it is producing for us an absolutely incomparable eternal weight of glory. Listen, every problem you've ever faced in your life and every problem you're facing right now is because we are living in a world that has been corrupted by sin. And we're all sinners. But God has ordained that a day is coming when a new heaven and a new earth will be created and there will be no more sin. And because there will be no more sin, there will be no more sorrow and no more pain and no more suffering and no more tears and no more death. And whatever you're going through right now, the day will come The day will come when that will be absolutely nothing, and it won't even be worth mentioning when we stand in His presence in His glory. Now, what's the so what of this passage? What do I want you to leave here with today? Let me give it to you in a little bit of a parable. It's an old story. You've probably heard it before. Every preacher's told it. There's no way to verify it, but it makes the point. Alexander the Great was the leader of the world, most powerful man in the world. And one day, one of his military leaders told him that there was a man in battle who had turned back, who had retreated when the order was given to advance. And how did Alexander the Great want him to handle that man? Alexander the Great told him to bring him to see him. So he stood before Alexander the Great. He said, "Son, they tell me that you ran in battle." "Yes, sir." "Son, they tell me that you were afraid." "Yes, sir." "Son, what is your name?" "Sir, my name is Alexander." "What is your name?" "Sir, my name is Alexander." And Alexander the Great said, "Son, you either change your name or you change your behavior." I wonder if God might say that to some of us. You say you're a Christian? You say that you love God and follow Jesus? You say that He's the Lord of your life, and yet this is the way you live? This is the way you talk? This is the way you treat people? I wonder to whom He would say today, "You either change your name. Stop saying you're a Christian, or change the way you're living." Just this one thing. Let us live our lives for the gospel of Jesus Christ, so that all the world might hear that He is Lord. Let's pray. Lord, help us today to commit to consistency, to cooperate. We're not in this alone. We cannot do this by ourselves. Help us, Lord, to have courage and to seek in all things to be a little bit more like Christ. I pray for someone today who's burdened. I pray for someone today who's in the middle of the storm. They need people to stand around them to help them stand firm. I pray for someone today who's afraid, that they would hear this word, that God has not given them the spirit of fear, but a sound mind and courage, and that together we can stand against our enemies. Lord, help us to be a little bit more like You today than we were yesterday. And help us to be a little bit more like You tomorrow than we are today. And Lord, help us to live this day as if this were the only day we had to live. And we stand before You at the end of the day, that what we would hear You say is, "Well done, well done, well done." We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor Bruce is going to be here. I'm going to be here. Greg's going to lead us in a song. We'd love to have you become a part of our church. Some of you need to do that. It's time to do it. This is where you worship. This is where you serve. This is your church. Make it official. We'd love to help you with that. Somebody here today needs to trust Jesus as your Savior. I'm telling you, listen to me now. Listen real close. There's never been, in all the history of the world, there's never been a better day to trust Jesus than today. It's the best day. Don't let tomorrow come that you haven't trusted Jesus today. Let Him be the Lord of your life. If you need somebody to pray for you, we'd count it an honor. We truly would count it an honor to pray for you right now if you need someone to do that. So this is a time for you to respond. Let's stand together. Greg's going to lead us in singing. Bruce and I are waiting. If the Lord leads you, you come.
Cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide, and its grace so free is sufficient for me, and deep is its fountain, as wide as the sea. There's room at the cross there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Though millions have found him a friend and have turned from the sins they have sinned, the Savior still waits to open the gates and welcome a sinner before it's too late. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you.
Let's sing the chorus again. Would you sing it with me? Though millions have, now just the chorus, let's just the chorus. Never mind, you're through. I'm on. That chorus is one of the tough ones to get into. Bruce, I'm sorry. He said sing the chorus, and I just could not find a place to start it.
I can't help you with that, Greg. I'm sorry.
You know, when a pastor looks up and tells you to do something, you better do it.
Yeah.
How are we going to do this?
There's room at the cross for you.
Now, how hard is that?
I just couldn't find it.
There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one.
I didn't mean to do this.
Yes, there's room at the cross for you.
I give up.
Next week we'll work on Do Lord. How's that? Again, to all of our guests, thank you for being here today. It's our prayer you've been blessed. You felt the presence of the Lord today. Pastor and I'll be out in the foyer. Please come by. We want to meet you. Just say thank you for being here today. Have a gift for you as well. Pray you have a wonderful, wonderful week. Let's continue to pray for our neighbors to the south. God's protection upon them over these next hours. Greg?
A lot of people have asked us to do a staff quartet. There it was, without one. We needed Jerry up there. Jerry, next time we'll get you to come up with us, all right? So I collect these old paper hymn books and some old hymn books stained with tears and blood and whatever. And so I went back and found an old song. I hadn't heard it forever and ever. Jesus, the Light of the World. Goes like this.
Walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy are bright. Shine all around us by day and by night. Jesus, the Light of the World.
Got my people here today. See you next week.